do reference a couple things, just so people, everybody knows, just, you know, following through on a couple of more, just a couple of points that Sarah raised, and for people's knowledge, we are in a situation where, I'm sort of waiting for Chuck to see if there's something down there. If not, I'll just go ahead. But we're in a situation, for the moment, there's a kind of, let's say, a minor lull, as Sarah pointed out, in the Ukraine, the confrontation with Russia. And there are all kinds of things to be that she pointed to that are up in the air. I mean, we're talking about the British Empire. She went through it. And the issue isn't just the possibility of war with over Ukraine with Russia. The track of the British imperial force is war, global war, just as it was in World War I, as she referenced. So we have to look at the situation with respect to China, where we have Obama in Asia, I think in the upcoming week or so. And every time he's done one of these tours, he's stirred up trouble. This goes to the question of people are awfully confused about these things. Okay, I was going to do this. trouble, I'll come back. Trouble, you know, like he did with it when he was at The Hague a couple of weeks ago and went through and forced everybody to go through nuclear war games for a terrorist incident. Not the most peace-loving thing to do in preparation for a conference on nuclear weapons and so forth, or the red line in Syria. There's so much for, you know, Obama does get away with a lot of garbage just because, you know, he's supposed to be the first African-American president. Some people quibble over that. I'm not about to get into racial theories, but the reality is, despite that cover, everywhere he has gone, he has brought a certain level of destruction. Remember, we have aligned ourselves with the right-wing Japanese government of Shinzo Abe, who is trying to reorganize the Japanese constitution, or reinterpret the Japanese constitution, which was a constitution written under the guidance of Douglas MacArthur. And that constitution has often been called a pacifist constitution. Abe wants to change it to allow for the Japanese to engage in collective defense. Okay, what does this mean in practice? There's a dispute supposedly over territory in the South China Sea, in the Japanese Sea, and so on and so forth. Really, a bunch of rocks, you know, in the Straits of Taiwan and so forth. And these disputes are disputes between China, Japan, the Philippines, Korea, South Korea, etc. So this would be an action of collective defense. It's already underway. Now, for those of you who may recall, one of the most intense points of the Cold War was not just the Cuban Missile Crisis, but the conflict over Kimoi and Matsu, which were another couple of these relatively desolate islands, in that case, in what was then called the Straits of Formosa. And there was nearly a shooting war over that, which the United States would have been involved in. So, you know, the China situation is there. The Syria situation has not gone away. And I'll tell you, if you want a perfect example of the British Empire, we don't need to get into relatively arcane things like the British involvement in the Caucasus, the fact that this was part of the Chechen Wars of the 1990s, 100 years after the British mucked around in this. But all you need to do is look at the Middle East. What we call the Middle East, there's no way to understand it without understanding the Sykes-Picot Agreement of 1916. Because everything we call the Middle East, the boundaries were drawn under the Sykes-Picot arrangement. And those boundaries, which were, you know, in part a French protectorate, a French mandate, a British mandate, and most of what we call the countries were formed then, and they were divided up in strange ways, including Syria, Jordan, the Palestine mandate, which was a British mandate, everything we call the Middle East. And to this day, it's everything that's manipulated in the Middle East, including the Israeli-Palestine conflict. All of this is orchestrated by a British imperial force, which were the experts. The French were drawn in as junior partners because the French have their own imperial ambitions. But they're largely subordinate to the British and have been subordinate to the British, you know, really at least going back to, you know, Napoleon and then later the end of the 19th century. And the French simply decided to go along to get along, as sort of, you know, picking up the scraps that fell off the table. So that's what we're faced with under this collapse. What will the British Empire do? Not what will Obama do. The relevant feature of Obama is that with Obama in, and Obama is nothing but a British agent. And by that, what I can prove about that, well, there's some funny stories, but what I can prove about it is this is a guy who's been trained in the British School of Law, Philosophy, and Economics. He's a follower of Adam Smith, of people really like Edmund Burke. I wonder how many people realize, for example, that the mentor of Woodrow Wilson, who's of course the granddaddy of the so-called 20th century liberal Democrat, was Edmund Burke. Now, for those of you who don't know, Edmund Burke was the leading Tory political thinker of the end of the 18th century. The entire fabric of their outlook is anti-American. Wilson was a Confederate supporter, and, I mean, his family was, and then he was after he was young during the war, he was a kid. But as an adult, he explicitly supported the Southern outlook. This is the great hero of a good chunk of the Democratic Party. He compared unfavorably the British Parliament system to the American legislative system. That is, he preferred the British parliamentary outlook explicitly. Now, there's some complications in that he wanted a strong president, but because he had ambitions of being president from the time he was an adolescent. So Obama himself, his outlook on economics, on politics, is British. And his mentors are British. Cass Sunstein, Samantha Powers, these are at London School of Economics, Oxford, Susan Rice. These are people who proudly have an imperial outlook, often in the guise of human rights, which they have no intention of doing a damn thing about. And so our task, the fact that they have Obama with his finger on the button, that is, the one thing the British Empire lacks at the moment is military power. And a certain, their financial power is in combination between London and Wall Street. Okay? So their basic outlook is we need Obama. If they don't have Obama in the White House, the strategy of using confrontation and the threat of nuclear war, knowing that these are the kind of people that would go for nuclear war, they would lose. They would certainly not have that capability. And anyone who thinks that they don't have that outlook, just think of Prince Philip, the consort, who said famously, we have, you know, that he's so concerned about population growth, and people don't take this seriously, he's so concerned about population growth that he would like to come back as a virus to aid in the depopulation of the world. That is his outlook. That's the Queen's outlook. That's the outlook of the oligarchy of this empire. And of course, that oligarchy has its fingers and tentacles in many different places, even by family to this day, but largely through financial control. Control of various forms of financial flows and so forth. That's the nature of this empire. So our task has been to remove Obama by constitutional means. Now we have a new flank that's developed on that, which we're going to be working out over the next couple of days even, which is the situation in Texas, which of course is, you know, by area, the second largest state in the Union, by population, the second largest state in the Union. And then we have a different subsidiary flank in California itself, which of course by area is the fourth largest state in the Union, and by population, the first largest state in the Union. And these two states have been under conditions of drought and economic and political and economic collapse. In particular, in Texas, we've had a continuously declining Democratic Party and a Republican Party that's only acknowledgeable because of its unbelievable stupidity. In this case, stupidity is a political crime. So if you're stupid, at least you should have enough sense not to run for office or try to run the country. Okay, so we have a very interesting situation in a Senate race. We have a young woman, Keisha Rogers, African-American, who has won two Democratic Party congressional primaries in 2010 and 2012. Now, she's running for U.S. Senate this year. And in the first run of the primary, the way they, without going into the details, they have a system where you have a bunch of people run the first time. And if nobody gets 50% plus one, then the two highest vote recipients have a runoff. Now, in this case, the Democrats have no real candidate. The candidate that they're running, Al Emile, who's made a few hundred million dollars in a dentist clinic or something, spent $3 or $4 million. And this is a guy who supported the, I think it was Lieutenant Governor, Republican Lieutenant Governor running for an office. He supported Rick Perry, who's one of the hardline neocon governors of the country, with tens of thousands of dollars. So this is a guy who's largely supported Republicans financially, or certainly famously financially. And now he's running for the Democratic Senate. Now, because he put in $3.5 million, he got about 47% of the vote. Keisha got 22% of the vote. So therefore, she's in the runoff. She finished second amongst a half a dozen candidates. Now, don't worry about those numbers, because you have to realize the turnout for that primary, in terms of the voter turnout, was in single digits. I believe it was less than 10% of the eligible voters. Okay, so that doesn't tell you anything about the runoff election. Now, what we do know is we get more bang for the buck, okay? So we're going to be doing what we can within our limited but expanding financial capabilities. So radio ads, billboards, I think we've already paid for billboards, and the idea will be to throw a complete wrench into the, not into the Democratic and Republican Party, because were Keisha to win that primary, it would turn things so far up and down that she would be in a position to run a serious campaign against the incumbent senator, John Cornyn, who's another one of these neocons. And the fact of the matter is, the Republicans have made asses of themselves. For example, everybody loves this guy, Ted Cruz from Texas, because he's a Tea Party, small government, don't tax me, blah, blah, blah. Tough guy who's claimed that he wants to impeach Obama. But none of them have put a single step forward on impeaching Obama. And what's their line? Well, keep Obama in, because that way we'll win in 2016. Now, if that isn't immoral, I don't know what is. That's a little bit like people who used to say, Well, it's good that Hitler's in now, because people get so upset with him, we'll win the next election. There never was a next election. And so this is the kind of famously immoral policy we have. So the main thing I would add to what Sarah said is we're going to be running a very serious, in the next 6 weeks, mobilization, no matter what the odds, to defeat, to win the election in the Senate Texas Senate race. And then 1 week later, we have Mike's campaign against Pelosi, which would be we should think of this as a 1-2 knockout punch. Because if you had a victory in Texas, all bets are off in terms of what's going to happen in other elections. And you have to recognize that if it's a long shot, that's the shot we should take. Because nothing else accomplishes anything. Now, I think we can take off, and some of what I'm going to discuss. Oh, I was going to make one announcement. Anybody who has their cell phone, turn it on. If your wife is pregnant, or your sister, or your daughter, put it on buzz, and if it buzzes, you can go out and take the phone call. Otherwise, no answering cell phones, no texting, no sending smoke signals through the burnt up wires of your cell phone. Okay? Now, what I want to go through, because it will have to be a little bit concise, is the situation that we really have to face and why we have to win these things. Because actually, the destruction that we face is not just thermonuclear war. Let's say we avoid that for the moment, although I sure don't want to let anybody off the hook. But let's say we avoid that for the moment. We're faced with destruction anyway. You have to recognize that the ecology movement, or the environmentalist movement, so-called, which is the movement of depopulation that goes back to Malthus, Darwin. This is British policy. It's Venetian policy. This was taken up from Venetian economists like Gio Maria Ortez in the 18th century, and so on and so forth. The idea is we can't feed that many mouths. I mean, their basic view of human beings, if you want an image of it, is think of a bunch of little birds, you know, whatever they call them when they're just hatched, in one of those nests halfway up a tree. You ever see what that looks like? You know, mom and dad go out and catch something, and they come and regurgitate it. And the way they regurgitate it is, it's the action of the little birds moving up and down with their mouths wide open, screeching and screeching, that sets off the reflex, so they regurgitate it into the mouths of these poor little fledglings. Okay. Now this is sort of the oligarchic outlook, except they're not about to go through the whole process of regurgitating, and if they don't have enough food, some of the birds aren't going to make it. And that's life. We have a faction of the human species, which is questionable as to whether it's really human, who believe that they rule. And this is captured in certain myths that are not really myths. I'm not an expert on Greek mythology, but people know, Zeus is the successive god of the Olympians, who take over from the Titans and so on and so forth. And that's the mythology. Zeus ultimately overthrows Kronos and becomes the new god, the new chief god. Then we have the gods of all kinds of other things. And the basic view is that these gods, these immortals, really sit up there being immortal with all the normal desires. So what are we dealing with? We're dealing with an oligarchy. That's what it represents, and that's what it is. That's the historic reality of the gods of Olympus. These are actually historic figures, somewhat mythologized. They are the emperors, the rulers. And you have this in many imperial forms, in this form. The Persian Empire. And then we reach a point where this reduced itself to essentially one empire, the Roman Empire. At least in the Western world. There were Asian forms of empire. Really, the British Empire, which is the successor to Rome and Venice, is probably the single largest empire ever to exist. It's a global empire. Look at the Commonwealth. Look at the seats of financial power. London and Wall Street. Now, Wall Street is an offshoot of London. And it's been that since its founding at the end of the 18th century. But, you know, one interesting reflection of it is that what was Wall Street? Wall Street was where they used to do the slave auctions at the end of the 18th century and the early 19th century. And, of course, a great deal of the wealth of Wall Street, as well as Boston, was based on the drug trade, the cotton trade, the slave trade, which is why Wall Street and Boston and London supported the Confederacy. And it's what we're dealing with to this day. Most of the outlook that demonstrates that, you know, Obama and company, Cheney and company are British agents is their adherence to what we would say in the U.S. is a Confederate outlook. They base themselves essentially on the Confederate Constitution, which is against the development of infrastructure, which rejects debt or credit, which rejects the General Welfare Clause and the preamble of the Constitution. So we're dealing with our own historic enemy. But of course, you know, and another way to look at this is, of course, the Iliad by Homer. Because what do you get in the Iliad in the broadest sense? And this is something that actually happened, as was proven during the 19th century. This is not mythology. Troy is a city that existed. And the siege of Troy is an event that happened. And so what is this? What is the basic background of the story of Iliad? And ultimately the Odyssey in a different way, but the Iliad. You have the Olympian gods sort of in their overweening boredom manipulating the poor mortals. So it's not Agamemnon who's the emperor. In Zeus. And then you have the demigods who are, you know, born of the relationship between, think of it, the relationship between the gods and the mortals. Now here's, right, you have a god impregnating and producing a child that's, you know, has some superpower, basically. Like Achilles. And so the myth is an expression of a reality. These were emperors who existed. Whether their name was Zeus or not, I don't know. Now, in the relevant Western reflection of this, you have the case by Aeschylus of Prometheus versus Zeus, or Prometheus bound, Prometheus unbound. And who's Prometheus? This is the important. Prometheus is foresight. That's essentially what the word means. And he's a semi-god. And he's decided, because what happens, as in many mythologies, including Sumerian myths and so forth, the gods have decided it's time to wipe out the human species. They're too populous. We don't need this many. It's time to, and this is an animal-like conception, literally. There comes a time when the offspring of the human beings are too numerous. And so what do? You kill them. Now, of course, animals carry this out, even though most human beings these days don't like to believe these things about our poor romantic animals. But most animal species, even the pleasant ones, you know, like horses and cats and dogs in the wild, or, you know, wolves and so forth and so on, if the male member of the species who dominates an area finds the offspring of another male, he'll kill them. This is true of chimpanzees, it's true of lions, it's true of, you know, all kinds of, including relatively peaceful species like gorillas or horses in the wild. It's a form of population control. Yes, supposedly, you know, it also, you know, the stronger, but it's really, that's not what really works. It's a form of population control. What's Prince Philip's outlook? We've bred too many of them, so we have to get rid of them. And as Bertrand Russell said, truly, in a more fundamental way, the single most evil people of the 20th, person of the 20th century, in the sense of knowing exactly what he was doing. Others may have directly seemed to have killed more people, but Russell knew what he was doing. And he intended to leave a legacy which would guarantee the ongoing murder of human populations. And he wasn't too quiet about it. And what Russell understood, that a lot of other bad people, including Adolf Hitler, didn't understand, was that if you won the battle, if you were hegemonic, and this is what makes the British Empire significant, if you won the battle for what we thought human beings' nature was, and better to use an even more technical term, if you won the battle for the nature of the substance of human beings, what are we really made of? What is our actual self-subsisting quality? That is, what is it that we ourselves, as human beings, socially and individually, what is it that we do that is the nature of our existence? Or, yeah, it's interesting to me, or as MacArthur put it, when we talk about this kind of issue, we're in the area of theology or spirit. Now, I don't think he meant you have to get religious. We're talking about things that have to do with these topics: the nature of time, mortality and eternity, the nature of creation itself, the nature of human beings. And in a sense, that's what you have to get at what the American system, or the American system of physical economy, or the mystery of credit is. People get, you know, people immediately think technical financial terms. But that's not the point. Now, what did Prometheus do? Prometheus brought fire and knowledge, really, as he says, in at least in Aeschylus's version, when he talks about astronomy and so on and so forth, agriculture, calendars, but he brings fire to humanity. Now, what is fire? Fire is the instrument of change. Fire is the first, it's the beginning of the process of us being able to act on nature in a way that actually changes the physical chemistry of nature. Now, there are a lot of things that we do that I think are more interesting sometimes than we give it credit for, because people get very wigged out about some of this stuff. Okay? So, you know, we make tools. We go, as far as we know, tool making amongst the human species goes back probably 2 to 2.5 million years. And it becomes increasingly sophisticated. I won't go through all of the stuff on that. Stone tools, the development of different cultures of stone tools, sharper stone tools, more developed stone tools, designed stone tools. And this goes on for a long period of time. Now, there are a lot of people, and I'll say something like, there are a lot of people who say, well, you know, animals make, it's frankly, you know, crap. You know, they'll show you some raven with their brain the size of a pea. And it is interesting. There's something interesting in the amount of circuitry that can go into the neurological system of a chicken. Fine. I mean, they don't really even have a brain. They sort of have a bud at the end of their central nervous system. Okay. And that's why you get the famous case where the chicken keeps going around for quite a while after you cut the head off, because there ain't that much in the head. It's sort of like clipping his nails. Okay. So, but you know, you have ravens, you know, they're clever. They've learned to drop stones on eggs and break them. They've learned to use sticks to dig into holes. But this isn't tool making that with the way, it's incomparable. Of course, when you get to the idea of steel making or polyesters or plastics, there's no comparison. It's a different universe entirely. But people say, well, I even seen the most recent thing I saw was they found on an island, I think, off of Australia, that they had some, I think it was crow-type birds, and they have, quote, different cultures. Because, you know, one set of crows uses a stick a certain way, and one of them has more than a stick, and they divided up, and they found out it occurred in zones, and the zones were somewhat by descent. So therefore, they have cultures. Now, what kind of idiot compares a culture? Culture is law. Culture is science. Culture is art. You compare that to the different sticks that seven different families of birds make? You got to be a nutcase. It's an absolute irrelevancy. But the problem is, we've had a serious amount of, you know, this environmental brainwashing on this crap. My favorite example, I even saw an updated example, you know, people talk about climate change. That we're going through climate change. We've always gone through climate change. No one knows, you know why they use the word climate change now? Because they're not exactly 100% sure that it's global warming. For those of you old enough, you may remember at the beginning of the environmentalist movement, it was global cooling. Then when that was proven to be wrong, they said it's global warming. They've sort of stuck to global warming, but they're hedging a little bit. It might be climate change. Because there are people who say, no, it's going to be cooling. And probably, given the fact that astronomical factors are larger in this than any of their models have, we're probably headed for global cooling. But leave that aside, there's always been climate change. There has never not been climate change. We had a mini ice age not that long ago. Look at California. We have a drought. We've had droughts before. It's a dry climate. That could change. Take Washington State. They have a desert on the eastern side of the mountain. It used to be a lake. They had floods. Take South Africa. It used to be green. Now it's most of it's dry. When you have ice ages, for example, in the north, you have often enough droughts in the southern hemisphere. Because what happens to the water? It gets accumulated in the glaciers. And so there's less precipitation, sometimes. There's always climate change. Extinctions. Extinctions go, you know, there have been five major extinctions. We cover this in some of our videotapes that were done from the basement. The mother of all extinctions was 250 million years ago in the Permian, when 98% of the life on the planet was destroyed. You want to know the truth? Nobody knows why these things happen. Including we made some hypotheses about looking at galactic factors, solar factors. But we still don't know why those extinctions happened. You'd have to take a much more serious approach to it. What now? But what has happened in the course of these developments? The organization and the energy flow, the energy, what Lynn calls the energy flux density of life on the planet has increased. Of life, of the biosphere, of things related to life, and of the living organisms themselves, or at least the most developed of those living organisms. And everything in the biosphere takes part in that increasing energy flux density. That is the amount of flow, but really we're not talking about energy as a scalar. What we really mean is the amount of flow that increases the ability to do work on the biosphere itself. So we can control increasingly smaller areas and open those areas up to ever more investigation. And therefore we can draw more and more out of our relationship to nature in terms then of our ability to control larger processes. So for example, we now have nuclear capabilities, which gives us the ability through control of the flow of power from those processes to concentrate that power in such a way that we can open up new areas of investigation. Electromagnetism did the same thing. So we can have magnetohydrodynamics. We can use other nuclear processes to transform elements so that the table of elements changes, becomes more controlled. And that gives us the kind of power that allows us to then do things on the larger scale, like perhaps developing the moon. And it also gives us access to new scientific principles, further development, which reflects the creative powers of mankind, which in a certain sense is a replication of the creative forces in the universe that have given us the universe itself. The universe is creative. That is, it progresses in exactly the form that I've referenced. And the proof of that progress is the existence of the kind of capability that human beings have. That is, we have minds. Not brains, but we need a brain. And you need it to be relatively healthy in its functioning and its support. But the mind of a human being is not its brain. Now, in what form can we get at this? Well, it's exactly, look, what is the system that Lynn refers to as the American system? It's a system of the idea that the human species and the nation exists not only by scientific development and then the implementation of the relevant technology, but using that to create conditions under which we produce human beings and society that are able to use those science and technological developments to create further scientific knowledge and further technological development for further increases in human capabilities. Because whatever it is that we do, we always need to supersede. And so you've always got to be ahead of where you are. You've always got to be thinking of within what we know today, what will we then use up? What conditions will be created? And what will we be needing to do 50 or 100 years or however, or even further ahead, perhaps? That is, we need to know something about the future. Now, I'll come back to this point because there's more to it than seems. It's not just kind of guesswork. And it's not just, well, we have to think about the future in some sense of some future date. It's not a linear sense, it's a totally different sense of time. And we have an access to that in scientific discovery and to a certain degree, a greater degree really, in classical composition. Because in a way, in classical composition, you control the time. It's your time, where it's the time of the classical composition. Now the reality is it's not just yours, because there really are no human individuals. And yet that doesn't mean there's a collective identity. You are an individual, but as an individual, how did you come to have the mind that you have? What access did you have? What makes your mind the way it is? What makes you, what gives you the capability of thinking about certain things in the way you do? What gives you a sense of creativity? What gives you a sense of human power? It's the society into which you're born. It's the culture. Some cultures are not productive, others are. Imperial cultures are not productive. Their whole point is to reduce the capability of the human individual by cutting them off from history, from other human beings and other cultures, from the future, and in many ways, equally as much from the past. Not that you're going to replicate the past. In fact, there's an interesting quote from MacArthur on the South Pacific campaign, where he makes the point, where he says, look, you're not going to repeat the past. If you repeat the past, you lose. In military terms, you never run the same campaign again. Now, you might learn from the past, but you never run the same campaign again. And that it can be taken as a kind of marker for human existence. Yes, the past is important. Yes, the past is important in part because we want to have an obligation to the past, to the individuals of the past, to keep what they did alive. But also, the past tells us many things about human development, about the world that we live in, about the difficulties of human existence. But we always look at this from the standpoint of knowing that the characteristic of the past are the crises of development, of change. And so we take that as a marker for the quality of human development that we need. And as MacArthur said in his speech, and as Lynn has said over and over again, this is kind of, people get mystical or they get weirded out, but the fact of the matter is, we need a qualitative change in human beings. We need human beings who take responsibility for the future of society away from an oligarchy that treats other human beings as cattle. We have to have a quality of human being that doesn't define themselves in biological terms or even in simple traditional terms. We need a different sense of identity for human beings. Now, I'll come back to that point because I think this goes much more, I think, at what Lynn's been saying about sense perception than most of us think. Most of us think, because our problem is we think, okay, sense perception is wrong. You know, you have the example, you stick a stick in the swimming pool and it's crooked and you pull it out and it's straight and so there's an optical illusion and you can't trust your senses. And that can get pretty serious if you press the point, but nobody really believes that. It's not like you think you're going to walk to the left and fall off a cliff even though it looks like a room. I mean, people don't worry about that much. But in fact, if you understand what Lynn and others are talking about, it is about that dangerous. But it's not that simple. Because if you think of yourself as an isolated individual, as a body, as a thing, as a mass in space and time, and that's all you are, then you don't know what it is to be human. You think of yourself as a box to be filled up with all kinds of sensibilities. A thing. And that's why people worry about getting old. Sure, people worry that they get gray hair, they want to dye their hair, or they pull their hair out. You know, people can do that if they want, but people worry about they're getting old, they got wrinkles, they look old, they have to go to the doctor more, death is near, it gets closer and closer. Well, of course, it was getting closer from the time you were born. The only thing that is that you didn't know it. You know? And you sort of say to yourself, well, since I don't know if I'm going to die tomorrow, I'm not going to think about it. I just assume I'm not. And when if it hits me, as infamously Lynn said the other day, don't tell me about it. Well, that's, in a funny way, you don't want to be morbid, but that's a mistake. Because indeed, you do have an existence as a human being that is not the mortal flesh. In fact, most of what you do, first of all, most of what you're capable of doing does not come from within your own flesh. It's something that you, so to speak, inherit from the society that you're born into, from the cultural situation, from what you fight for politically. Then you're given that as a legacy. The question is, what do you do with it? As Franklin infamously said to that woman outside of the Constitutional Convention, we've given you a republic if you can keep it. And so you realize that your identity is not what you look like. It's not what you feel like. Your identity is what you, as an individual, absorb and contribute to the future of human existence, to the rest of society in your time, and their ability to contribute along with yourself to future discoveries, or the rediscovering of discoveries. That's the identity that Alexander Hamilton placed in the Constitution, preamble of the Constitution, in the Federalist Papers, and in his paper, economic papers, including the constitutionality of the National Bank. But what did he identify? What was the point of the constitutionality of the National Bank? What did he identify? The purpose of the nation is to preserve the ability of the nation to create a future. Future generations, and create the conditions under which those future generations could create a future. It's not good enough to just say, okay, we've done good enough, we know the country's going to last another 100 years. But when we get to that end of that 100 years, are we going downhill, or are we at the point that those people 100 years from now understand the need to progress beyond themselves? Such that the human species then becomes, in itself, an immortal species, an eternal species. And then you look at existence from the standpoint of creation itself. Because effectively what you're doing is creating the conditions under which we learn more and more about creation. About how the universe creates itself, develops itself, produces human beings. And you know, there's all these interesting questions about, are we alone? I don't know. If we're not alone, there's another question. Is it possible to get where others are? That's another interesting question. We don't know the answer to that one either. We may be alone. I've always had the view that if we're not alone, we have one good thing to hang on to. You know, we might run into problems, etc. You know, science fiction, Star Trek, Star Wars, God only knows what. But I have the one point from a sort of a philosophical standpoint that you can make, which is, since it's one universe, at least that's the one universe we live in. The multiverses are a little, that's another wacko mathematical projection. But even on that theory, we're stuck in this universe. And of course, the problem with that outlook is if there's a multiverse, there's probably some lawfulness that governs all the multiverses. So we're still talking about one universe. There's always a unifying aspect because the human mind has that capability. I'll come back to that point. But the reality is, if there are intelligent beings, then their intelligence is defined by creativity. That's the nature of the universe that we live in. And therefore, the basis for communication will exist. Since they if they're intelligent, their intelligence is based in creativity, not some kind of facts or machines. And if they're creative, then we have the basis for communicating. We can figure out a way to communicate. So we don't have to be afraid of the rest of the universe. And I think that's a better way to look at things anyway. Now, what has this got to do with credit? Because this is the basis of credit. What the idea of credit itself is not that complicated. What complicates people is the idea of money. Credit, you issue credit from the standpoint of a national policy. And you say there are these credits, and the form or the mechanisms you want to make sure are properly regulated. And you can have private interests. And the credit, but that's how you, that's the basis upon which you circulate currency, which basically is simply used to make sure there's a proper exchange, not only in the division of labor, but in the process of future development. Because indeed these projects are projects of 5, 10, 15, 20 years. They're scientific projects, they're infrastructural projects. People add innovations, because the whole point is to increase the productivity of the society as a whole. And really, beyond the productivity, to increase the energy flux density of society, which is a manifestation of scientific progress, of us knowing more about the way the universe works. And so that's credit, and money is subordinated. Money itself has no value. I was telling people on the phone team, I did get a kick about this. On the way over here from the East Coast, thankfully, once in a while, when you're in the coach section of these wonderful aircraft, which are interesting technologically, but the way they do it now, you kind of sit there with your knees in your face and so forth. But unless you're an experienced traveler like me and you always get the exit row. So the... they have free movies. So we watched this movie called The Wolf of Wall Street. Okay. And frankly, it has, despite a certain manic quality to it, it has some interesting aspects. But the part I liked was very early on, so you don't even have to watch. This young guy goes in and he wants to be a broker because he's from Queens and he thinks this is the way up. Ultimately, he becomes a complete nut, but this is in the beginning. And he goes to L.F. Rothschild, one of the Wall Street brokerages, and he goes in and he meets the top brokers, and it's a totally manic scene throughout, man screaming, jumping up and down. So he comes in rather quiet. He wants to learn the ropes. So the best broker at the firm, this is about 1985, 86, something like that, takes him out to one of these, these restaurants on the 88th floor, super expensive, and he sits down, the guy's like 40, 45, and he's 20-something, and he says, he starts out saying, we're trying to help people and invest, and the older broker says, oh, cut the bullshit, we're here to make money. Don't tell me about what you're going to do for society. We're here to make money. Meanwhile, he's ordering, you know, martinis, he's snorting a line of Coke, and he's lecturing this guy on, you know, we're going to get the money from those guys because they don't even know how to enjoy the money the way we do. But the best part line was at one point he said, look, we don't produce anything. We never did produce anything. We never will produce anything. We make money out of thin air. That's our job. That's all we want to do is make more and more money. We don't want to produce anything. Now, believe it or not, that's Wall Street, that's London, that's the oligarchy. The fact of the matter is, as manic and crazy as the movie was, it's probably as bad or worse in these real... And of course, the punchline of this was the firm that he started to work for on Black Monday of 1987 went bankrupt. Like all these firms eventually, Lehman Brothers, you name it, and it's all a scam. They don't produce a thing. They produce more money. And they don't want to invest the money because they want the money to increase in value more rapidly than any investment could ever accomplish. And that's why you need regulated forms of credit. Now, what's the other aspect of what Hamilton was doing? A national banking system. A federal banking system. Not a Federal Reserve, because that's a private banking system or a semi-private banking system in which the Congress gave up its entire control of the Federal Reserve. But a national bank is basically a bank in under the control of the Department of the Treasury. And what you then have is a unified national policy of development. And without a unified policy, you do not have a nation. The United States, as Lynn puts it sharply, and I'm sort of combining little bits of two papers that he recently wrote, one on science education, which I'll probably have to come back to another point, but and one on the U.S. economy. Okay, now what's the point of a national bank? You need a union that comes first. As Lincoln famously said, there are no states without a union. If you have something like the Articles of Confederation, you don't really have states. They don't have power. They don't have commerce. And even more than that, if anything, they're independent, each an independent separate nation. There's got to be some unity that makes a nation on economic policy, social policy, and so forth. And that comes first. You did not have the states of the United States until you had the Constitution of 1787 to 1789, which declares, first of all, what's the purpose of the Constitutional Convention? We, the people of the United States, in order to form 13 states, in order to form a more perfect union. If you look at the first Federalist paper, the union comes first. This is one of the biggest problems we have in the United States today. This movement of little government is stupid. It's anti-American. It's a violation of the Constitution, step number one. You want, you know, I can, there's a certain ridiculous quality to it. Because what people actually think is if we were a small little government, everybody would leave us alone and we wouldn't have to fight for anything. It's exactly how you run an empire. You keep everybody small. What do you think would have happened to the 13 colonies, or what was already happening to the 13 colonies under the Articles of Confederation? They were being ripped apart by different agreements with British foreign trade, free trade policy. We had no militia, we had no army. We had no central currency. We had did not have rules of commerce. And this is what's meant by the implied powers of the Constitution. Effectively, everything that the central government, the federal government, needs to implement that unified policy is implied as its powers. And what's left to the states is literally what's left over. And you see some of this idiocy. I'll give you an example of idiocy. You have this thing, just the argument, not the case. Scalia, this guy is a complete abomination. Scalia, there's a famous libel case ruling, Sullivan versus the New York Times. Now, what is the story on this? Who was Sullivan? How many people know that? Nobody knows that. Sullivan was the police chief or sheriff of a county in Alabama. What was the case? There was an ad in the New York Times signed by prominent supporters of Martin Luther King, including Eleanor Roosevelt. And in it, they didn't name anybody, but they said there were injustices and violence brought against protesters. And so Sullivan sued the New York Times for libel. Okay? Saying that that everybody knew that they were talking about him. Okay? So the Supreme Court ruled, and this is about 1960-something, the Supreme Court ruled that it was not libelous, because in order to be a libel, you have to mention the guy's name, and it has to be a malicious lie, and so forth. So this is considered part of freedom of the press. And frankly, I don't think it's bad. But what happened, the reason it went to the Supreme Court is in Alabama's court ruled that he should be paid $500,000 for libel. They ruled in favor of the sheriff. Okay, the Supreme Court overturned the ruling. Now, what's Scalia's argument? States' rights. Libel cases have historically been in the hands of the states, and the Supreme Court shouldn't have changed that. Now, this is a crock. Because here you have states and counties that are violating fundamental constitutional rights. That's a federal case. And that's what we're dealing with. That was people have never understood what Lincoln did in the Civil War. They still say, oh, he didn't emancipate the slaves. Lincoln was anti-slavery to the marrow of his bones. You know, now people often try to project into Lincoln current developments. Lincoln was not, in a certain sense, one who was arguing about who was smarter, whether people should live in the same neighborhood. That wasn't his problem. You know, he often said, particularly later, he developed an even greater respect from working with people like Frederick Douglass, and of course the whole of the African Americans who joined the Union Army. So Lincoln changed. But it's not really the point at issue. There's no doubt that Lincoln opposed slavery and believed in equality of rights for African Americans or former slaves. But what was he doing in the Civil War? He said, number one, the first thing that we're fighting on is the maintenance of the Union. It's not an abstract right of secession. People get into this. If the South, if we believe in the secession of this and that, what about the South? Well, this is wrong. You're looking at what's the content of the fight. The Union had established itself on the basis of the Constitution. And to leave the Union on the basis of a principle that violated the principles for which you joined the Union, not against it, for it, is a violation of law, an appropriate law, a part of natural law. If the South had wanted to secede because the North was violating the Constitution, in an appropriate understanding, that's a totally different case. But they wouldn't do that, because the only way to fight it is to assert the powers of the union. So we have to understand, this is the question of the future. But it's not an abstract question of the future. It's not a date in a linear... See, the way most people think of this, how do they think of it? Well, we have a linear time. Okay, we're here in time. It's, April the 19th, 2014. And tomorrow is April the 20th, the next day is April the 21st, the next day is April the 22nd, and you make a forecast. On April the 21st, 2019, we're going to land on the moon. That's a prediction. So we then wait. Will this prediction come true? Now, there's a sense in which we live in a kind of linear time. The biological life unfolds in a certain quality of time. But that's not the time of the human mind. The time of the human mind includes the past and the present as an active force, because it's part of the human mind. It's part of the way we think and are capable of acting. And what we've been given in our existence, what we have as science, technology, infrastructure, education, etc. And then we're posed with the problem of what discoveries need to be made. Now, what's a discovery? A discovery is a physical principle, a principle of the development of the universe. Electromagnetic properties, nuclear properties, biological existence, life, noetic existence. And indeed, the way understand the universe is in terms of what it created, not simply the sequence of how it got there. That's reductionism. You're never going to get in creativity from a sequence of events to the principle of creation itself. Because the sequence of events are a linear sequence that never add up to the quality of change that occurs. Particularly when you have noetic processes that now willfully introduce those changes. But even in the previously existing conditions, there's nothing in the prior existence that tells you what changes. All you can get is a deductive mathematical approach. If we assume that everything is made up of these elements in this form, then these are the possible combinations. And that's all you can get. Everything is a tautology. In effect, it's all contained in the beginning. And it's just the unfolding of that beginning. In the real universe, there's processes that clearly reflect development and creation. Everything else you have is a pure mathematical model. What you're looking for is, when did these things break down, and when did something new that reflected a larger universal principle that encompasses the new development? And how does that change the way we look at what happened? Because now we realize that everything that happened before was not leading simply to the unfolding of what happened before, but to a new development that was not embodied in the rules that existed before. We have now discovered a new principle that also changes the past. Just like the creation of the United States changed our view of what the Renaissance accomplished. We wouldn't really understand CUSA if we didn't understand the United States. Yet you couldn't simply go from CUSA to the existence of the United States by some unfolding of a mechanical process. Now, you begin to realize that the human mind, what's a physical principle? And this, of course, this is a history. There's a history of this Aristotle versus Plato. These are for other times. And this is what Lynn begins to discuss by a real scientific education. Approaches the universe from the standpoint of its creative powers, that new developments will unfold as we discover more about the universe. Questions do exist. What do we need to do to find out what these things are? What is a galaxy? What's the system of a galaxy? You know, when Lynn says Kepler discovered the solar system, I think some people would have to admit, you scratch your head, well, he didn't discover the solar system. The solar system was there. No, he discovered that it was a system, that it wasn't just an accidental feature, that there was a unifying principle underneath the organization and development of the solar system, which has further implications. So what happens when we discover a universal principle? We discover something about the future. We're changing the nature of the future, because now human beings can act with greater power to bring into existence phenomena that didn't exist, which allows us to know more about the universe. For example, if we create fusion, or so other things we've done at the nuclear level, we're now doing things in the universe that didn't exist without human intervention. Yes, these processes existed, but they did not exist as controlled and experimental phenomena. Now we can do things to discover more, and we accelerate the rate of discovery. And we move to building a sense of identity that is based on the idea of knowledge, of creativity and creation itself, which gives us an idea that the universe is not a finished product and never will be. It can't be, because indeed the direction of the universe is to create creative beings, which means the universe changes itself. And we have different powers. And now at this point, you know, we're actually, what's the nature of the existence of the human mind? As a mind, you have implicitly an existence in the future, because you've aided in changing human development. And now you know that your existence, though in a sense it's limited to your mortal existence, don't kid yourself, at a certain point you won't be able to do anymore to add to the store of what you've done. You will be dependent on others that follow you, which is why you'd like them to come. To be able to extend your existence. But you know that now. Which means, in a certain sense, you have a view of eternity. You won't know eternity, let's say, the way the Creator does. You are not creativity per se, but you are looking at creativity per se. You're experiencing and you're part of creativity as such. And this is why classical composition is so important. Because even in science, those discoveries, first of all, are stepwise at a certain level, and they unfold themselves over a greater amount of time. There are things that are going to occur that we don't quite know. When you create a great composition, a drama like Shakespeare, or a musical composition, in a sense, you're creating, in a limited way, a universe. What do you do in music? You establish a certain palette of sound, of music, of a theme. And that gives you a sense of the universe that you're operating in, within certain rules of composition, with certain ideas of composition, not notes. You use the notes to express the idea, not the other way around. It's not the notes that add up to the idea. It's the same principle. Now, in doing this, because it does, as heard, unfold in time, in a linear time. But to the mind, it's not a linear time. In a sense, from the very beginning, you're hearing the end. And from the very, not just from the end, you know, it's not just that at the end you refer back and hear the beginning. In a sense, as you put yourself in the mind of the composer, from the beginning, you have a sense of the end. And not just because you heard it before.
you're experimenting in your own mind, what is going to happen? You have to think as though you were perhaps the composer, or recognize that that idea is being posed to you. So in that sense, to be extreme, for that universe, you're experiencing eternity. In a sense, it's finite but unbounded, because it also exists for further development, for further musical development. So there's a future even to the future in that composition. And it's a perfect example of the human mind, because there's a dialogue between Bach and Mozart, Haydn, Bach, and Mozart. Bach, Haydn, Mozart, Beethoven, Schubert, and in some ways the dialogue has ended, but not necessarily forever. Now, the point isn't to get all exalted, but the point is to understand the nature of human identity, because it's not just you. It's human beings. And in fact, you couldn't really carry out your purpose in life without other people having the same sense of purpose. At least in the broad sense of ordering creativity. And that's the point of the American Republic. That's at least embedded in the sense of identity of somebody like Hamilton or Franklin or Lynn. And we have to recover that. And we have to give that. Look, this, the problem you have with youth, I mean, for one thing, I think there's a little bit too much of an idea, well, they're all screwed up. That's not the point. The point is why. And I'll tell you why. Computers. Digital systems. It makes people autistic on top of everything else. I mean, it'd be interesting to pose, why are there so many autistics being diagnosed? Now there's some question about the diagnosis and so on and so forth. But let's assume for the moment, I would make the following hypothesis. If there really is an increase in autism, why? Well, yeah, I'll tell you what it does. Autism is, frankly, the average four-year-old is autistic. In the sense that they're not social, they use language in bizarre ways, it's all about them. Everything is that's what a child is supposed to be like. You know, it's trying to figure the world out, wants mom to feed it, you know, breastfeed it, feed it, whatever the story is. And so children before a certain point are autistic. They use language as magic. They know that certain words get people to take care of them, certain words upset people. The problem is if you're fixed at a certain stage of development, at this kind of linear use of language, as a magical device, as an incantation, as a manipulation of adults. Now what happens if you're 3, 4, 5, 6 years old and you're stuck in front of a computer which basically responds to certain magical codes? You know, you learn how to fool around with the computer, you learn certain tricks of the trade, and it does things or doesn't do things for you, and you consider this knowledge. You consider this the truth. All of this depends on what's the standard of truth. What we have with Hilbert and Russell is a standard of truth that is completely linear, deductive, but I would say tautological. There's no new knowledge in anything that Hilbert or Russell does. There's no creativity. It's ruled out. And fundamentally, despite what people do with computers and recursive functions and so forth, computers can't be creative. They can mimic certain things, but the human individual actually has a capability of reflecting self-consciously on themselves as part of a universal process, of a process in development. And that's why no formal system contains the human mind. Because we're constantly able to look, what are all the principles we're operating by? What if I extend them to their limit? And these are thought experiments or actual experiments. What problems arise? And how do I, as a mind, knowing what the human species has done, how do I then change the principles that lead to this problem? So this goes to the whole question of freedom of will. Free will is a characteristic of the human species. But not from the standpoint of, I want to change my shirt, I want to have sex with my next door neighbor. That's not the question of free will. That's usually pure determinism. Yeah, you have an impulse, you want to follow it. I feel like eating, so I eat. I like this, I eat this. That's not freedom. You're actually controlled by your desires. Freedom is the freedom to create, to bring new principles to bear, to bring discoveries to bear, to improve the condition of humanity, to accelerate the development of humanity, to create conditions of evolutionary progress. Or really, it's revolutions. Because human beings willfully progress. We don't need to change biologically in any significant way. Whether that'll happen or not, I'm not about to predict. But that's not how we evolve. We've evolved over the last 500 years. The Renaissance was a point of evolution. It's a different world. You have to realize how different the world is to us with all of its problems than it was to somebody in the 14th century Europe. When, you know, you had a vocabulary of 300 words. Now, there were exceptions to that, but there was a lot of the population that suffered under those conditions. When lifespan was 30 or 40 years. That's why I always say to the Greens, you want to go back to the primordial condition of hominid existence? Okay. The average lifespan was probably 18 to 25 years. In the wild. It's like chimpanzees, you know, they can live to be 60 years old in captivity, but they don't live to be 60 years old in the wild. So we have to get this, and I like what the quote from MacArthur, similar to what Lynn is getting at. We have to define the identity of the human species and the human individual in that species. And that's why this issue of mind. Because we are not, and this is a little, not just to emphasize the question of immortality, because people, I always think there's a little personal greed in it, you know, a little bit like, okay, you know, I'm not talking about a substance that's going to, you're going to look down on yourself, you know, other people forever, or anything like that. It's a different kind of a different sense of what your existence is for. What's your substance? What's that which makes you live as a human being? It's your mind. It's that you're a development out of the past. And you have the potential to contribute to the development of future generations, of future societies, of future human condition. And that's your immortality. Otherwise, you have to face the mortality of the flesh. And that's really the only way to face it. Some people may happily go and say, my soul's going to go to heaven, whatever it's going to be. Good luck. If I'm wrong, then, you know, you win. The challenge is to, in a sense, to put it a certain way, you create your own soul. Because the human soul is a substance, is the self-development that you bring to the human species. Okay, that's about as far as I can go. Any questions? Yeah.
How the Americans slipped away to the British Empire back Wall Street, which was existing over 150 years in the hand of Americans. What was the loophole and which American president was responsible for it?
What's the last thing you asked? What's the last part? Which American
what? What was the loophole and which American president was responsible for it?
See, I don't think there was a loophole in the normal sense. Okay? You have to realize these are things of human beings. And there were problems that occurred at the founding of the United States which were not handled properly. Okay? And you know, I could say, in part, you could blame it on almost all the founding fathers, with the exception, Franklin died, with the exception of Washington and Hamilton, and later on Monroe. Because what you had, look, remember you had the French Revolution. The American Republic was isolated, was alone in the world by the early 1790s. Europe was being taken over by the British at this time. The British Empire was being formed at about the same time as an empire under Shelburne and so forth. So the loophole was, in fact, this whole question we're discussing now. But I would, in other words, what was the actual identity? Hamilton was the expression of the actual content of the American Constitution, including his four documents, the report on manufactures, on public credit, I always forget all these, you know, on the National Bank. These established the actual basis for carrying out the American system. Now what happened was that two things really happened. In the aftermath of Washington's presidency, there was already the beginning of a breakup between a pro-British, a sectionalist, and a pro-French, okay? And you see, Lynn refers to the fact that the first case of sectionalism in the United States was New England. Okay, they wanted to separate almost, I don't know, I remember the dates, other people may remember it better than I do, but the early 1800s, John Adams was prepared to promote the separation of New England because of certain trade and commerce relations with Canada and the British. And he was very pro-British, possibly for that reason. I don't know, you know, enough about every detail. Okay, Jefferson, meanwhile, had this anti-industrial, really, in that sense, pro-slavery. It wasn't just that he had slaves and just that he had concubines, which he did, but okay. But really, what was the problem? He was an agrarian. He didn't want industrial development. He was opposed to scientific development. He thought there was some benefit in this, you know, idyllic rural existence. And he was a supporter of the Jacobins. So you had, and then you had within that context, the assassination of Hamilton by Aaron Burr, who was a British agent and a supporter of Andrew Jackson and a supporter of the secession of the Western states as they came in. So we're faced with the same sectionalism, the same question of the British. It was only under Madison and so forth that Wall Street began to take over, that the slave trade was reintroduced, that this was the ties of Boston to the British, because it was really a Boston-New York axis. So the loophole was indeed the frailties and the pressure of the early days of the American Revolution and the immediately following period. Now what you've had since then, you have to look at this. You had Hamilton assassinated. Okay, you had operations against Adams that lead to Jackson. From Jackson on, you have basically the end of the Second National Bank, which functioned, even though I don't think it was ever fully in place in the way Hamilton wanted it in place. But it was out, even though it was finally out in 1837, it was deployed against before that. In 1837, you have the crash, you have Martin Van Buren, who is New York, who is Wall Street. Then you have the assassination of Harrison, who was probably a little bit better, the Zachary Taylor. Anybody who was associated with the Henry Clay, the better side of the American system, was who was elected was removed. Then Lincoln, in the Adams tradition, he comes in right after a complete traitor. Buchanan, Pierce before him, Polk. These were all pro-Southern, pro-slavery, etc. So Lincoln comes in and does, he more than comes in, Lincoln, Seward, and company, in the tradition of Adams, Quincy Adams, organizes the Republican Party effectively as a new anti-slavery pro-Republican party. Pro-Hamilton, pro-National Bank, a complete Hamiltonian. He introduces the greenbacks. He supersedes Wall Street. He rejects Wall Street. And he wins the Civil War. And the British were completely freed. Who supported the Confederacy? The British, Napoleon III, the French, the only ones who didn't support the Confederacy, the Austro-Hungarians, the papacy. The only ones who didn't, of significance, who didn't support the Confederacy were the Russians. Okay, so what happens? Lincoln is assassinated by the British out of Montreal, Quebec. John Wilkes Booth was funded by the British. It wasn't just Booth, it was a whole group of these guys who were funded by the Sons of Liberty and all these networks. You know, some of them were goofy, but all of them were coming out of Canada. Even though the British never formally endorsed the Confederacy, they were running operations against the Union during the entire war out of Canada, and they organized the assassination of Lincoln. But even despite that, because Grant wasn't bad, and there were, you know, Garfield was assassinated, McKinley was assassinated. Look at the American presidency. Who assassinated McKinley? A protege of Emma Goldman, who was an anarchist run out of British political networks. Yeah, I don't know the exact, we had some work on the guy who who assassinated Garfield was a guy named Guiteau or something, I forget. I don't remember the details on him that much. But Garfield was a pro-Lincoln figure. So then by the end, then you have Bismarck in Germany, who after a fight in Germany moves away from a free trade policy to an American system policy under directly Henry C. Carey, who was Lincoln's advisor. So the American system comes to Germany. When Grant went to Europe, the main thing he wanted to do was meet Bismarck, which he did. And interestingly enough, people like Grant and the guy who went with him from the New York Press, Young, viewed Bismarck as the leading figure of Europe, the leading intellectual political figure of Europe. That's not the view that most people have today. So the Germans were moving in that direction. You had Russia under Witte, in particular, and Mendeleev, with problems, but they were moving in this developmental direction. Prince Albert was deployed to destroy that development. Edward VII organized World War I. He organized the relationship between the Tsar and the Kaiser and so on, and the Austro-Hungarian Emperor, and they were all relatives of Queen Victoria. And so they pulled the string on World War I, which was a global war. They did the same thing with Japan. The British, of course, looted the hell out of China and India. And so this is, look, since that, you could almost say, except for the FDR interlude, since the end of the 19th century, there has been no American system. FDR was the only, I mean, you could say JFK was in that tradition, okay? Eisenhower was not a bad guy, but there was no American system politics of any significant sort. We did some right things sort of by instinct. And you had Kennedy, who had an American system approach, but he had 100,000 days in office. So for the most part, from the assassination of McKinley to the present day, We've had one president who operated consciously on the American system. He called it the American system. He referred to the preamble. But even he didn't implement a national bank. And that's a tough call for people. You know, the United States is screwed up, but it's the British Empire that runs the world. And so to the extent we don't name the British Empire, or even people who have decent policies, like Xi Jinping, or in some ways Putin, to the extent they don't name the British enemy, it's a weakness. Basically Tories, but we call them neocons because there were some conservatives, you know, coming out in the middle of the 20th century.